organizer. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the use of ocean gliders. You can see an image of one example. Three of that time are waiting in the Israeli custom to be released. Already for a while. So I'll explain a little bit what are these robots, these gliders, what they can do present day, and then I will talk a little bit about the next generation of such gliders. So as a part of an Horizon 2020 project, this bridges project, we are developing the next generation of gliders. So this is a nearly 8 million euros project, with 19 partners from 9 countries aiming to develop the next generation of gliders. Part of the motivation is the oil and gas industry, the mining industry, and some other purposes. We heard already in the previous talk that there are many concerns involved in this oil and gas industry, so there are environmental impacts at all stages, in the exploration, development, and so on. And these include the pollutant, the noise, releasing of all kinds of materials. You might also want to track and monitor even after the commission of certain wells. You already heard accidents can be the result of natural hazards, landslides, hurricane, maybe not in the Mediterranean, but in other places. Or as a result of the human factors, such as in the Deep Horizon. Some lessons that we learned from the Deep Horizon case, and we heard actually quite much more in the previous lectures. First, it is very difficult to estimate how much oil is actually released. In the case of the Macondo, the actual oil spill was much, much larger than was estimated at the beginning. And another interesting aspect was that, again, at least 50% of the oil actually didn't surface to the surface of the ocean. Much of it stayed at depths, and at depths it is very difficult to track the fate and where it goes. If we are talking about the Mediterranean, so although only less than 1% of the surface of the ocean is in the Mediterranean, actually over 20% of oil traffic is inside the Mediterranean Sea, and again, accidents and oil spill from ships are a major concern. And you can see some numbers, so between 77 to 2010, there were over 500 accidents in the Mediterranean, a significant amount of oil spill. So before I continue, what is a glider? So it's this toy, it's an underwater robot, autonomous robot. It can carry all kinds of sensors. It has the potential to carry wet payload and dry payload. The way it works, here you can see a kind of a diagram of this glider. It has a bladder, so you can control a little bit the buoyancy of this bladder, make it more buoyant or less buoyant. So according to Archimedes principle, this is how actually it will move forward or downward. There's also a mass inside the bladder, which you can move. It's this white rectangle. You can move it forward or backward. So if you want the glider to move forward and sink down, you deflate the bladder, so it makes it heavier than the water, and you move the mass forward, so then it starts to sink down, and it will sink until the designated depths. So when you want it to start and climb up, you take the mass backward, and you deflate the bladder, and now it starts to move. Upward, you can control it also the roll. You can move the mass to the right or to the left. And eventually, as a result of this way of propulsion, you get this kind of yo-yo track of this glider. Because to use a little bit of energy to deflate or inflate the bladder and move the mass forward or backward. But then throughout the dive, you don't use any energy for the propulsion. You use energy just for the sensor, which usually do not consume that much energy. You get a very long endurance. Such a glider can be in the water for weeks or months without the need to replace the batteries. And of course, it has a relatively limited payload, but we will see in a minute there are actually quite a long number of sensors that can be carried on this one. Then when it surfaces to the when you get to the surface, you can get in contact with the shore using a satellite, a iridium system, transmit part of the data, get new instructions, go to this waypoint, go to the other waypoint, do 10 dives before you surface again, and so on. So you get the data, the information, not in real time, but there is a delay of only a few hours between one contact and another. Here you can see a kind of an example of the data that you can collect. So this is a mission for nearly 2 weeks. The glider started from here. It moves initially northward and then it moved southward. So you can see the date. This was September 1st last year, 2014. And this was the 19th of September, the same year. What you can see here is the record. So this is the time from the beginning till the end. This is depth, and here we can see the temperature record of the temperature sensor that was on this glider. So you can see that you can get a nearly continuous record of the temperature, and you can put similar sensor for other parameters. I will mention in a minute a few of them. It's interesting to note that actually one of the first gliders ever was developed at the Technion by Danny Weiss at 78. You can see the model. This one actually dived in the water.
Nanoglider.
What?
Nanoglider.
Nanoglider, yes. But then, you know, eventually they didn't develop this glider anymore, but I saw this model. It's still on the desk of Danny Weiss. So what are the potential services? Of course, it can conduct hydrographic surveys, current, noise, radiation, all kinds of parameters which are relevant in pre-exploration, in the exploration stages, development, and all of them. You can also get data that can be used in operational ocean models. So in case that you do have an accident or an oil spill and you want to respond fast, you know, almost the only means that we have to predict where the spill will go is using ocean models, but these models need some data to get a better prediction. And you can also use it for leak detection. You can use it to survey pipelines, so you can get an early detection of leakage, and it has both economical and environmental benefits, of course. And you can also use the gliders just for underwater communication. If you have some instrument at the bottom of the ocean, 2,000 meters, you want to extract the data from them, you can send the glider with an acoustic modem, extract the data, it will surface again, and transmit the data to the coast, and you don't have to replace or change the instrument at the bottom very often. So the clients are both the industry and the regulator, so if you want to monitor the activity there, it's relevant for the people who actually do the operation and the people that want to monitor the activities. Already the existing gliders can be pretty useful for this industry. There are a long suite of sensors, some of them physical. There are now sensors for temperature, conductivity, passive and active acoustic, turbidity, radiation, as I mentioned, current, turbulence, and so on. There are also many biochemical sensors for fluorescence, dissolved organic matter, nitrate, oxygen, methane, and so on. But at least present-day gliders, most of them are limited to 1,500 meter depths, and they have a relatively limited navigation capabilities because the men use this change in buoyancy to move forward, and some inertial system in the compass to navigate, but they cannot really track, say, a pipeline very accurately. They also have to fight the current and so on. So in the next generation in this project, we are now working to develop a glider that will be two kinds of gliders. One of them will be for 2400 and the other one for 1500 meters. They will have also a propeller in addition to this glider, which you can inflate and deflate. So this propeller will enable them also to fly horizontally and to track the bottom more accurately and so on. We're going to have more intelligent management of the sensor on the glider itself, and there will be some connection between the sensors and the navigation units of the glider. So if the hydrocarbon sensor identified some leakage, the gliders will, for example, surface immediately and will contact the shore instead of waiting for another 10 hours until the next planned communication with the shore unit. We're also going to develop many new additional sensors, some of them for radioactivity, very time and efficient video camera, all sensor for organic pollutants, the possibility to look on particle and plankton size distribution and so on, and much more accurate navigation capabilities, so actually it will be able to follow, for example, the pipelines. So if to summarize, clearly we are not going to abandon this offshore industry. There are too many benefits, and we're going to utilize all the resources there, but we do want to somewhat preserve the environment. Another point of view of the regulators, I think by 2020, the marine science framework directive regulation of the EU will come into effect. I don't know if Israel is going to sign it or not, but I guess we will have to follow at least some of the directive there, some of the regulation. Until now, traditionally, most of the monitoring in the sea and most of the activity in case of accident and oil spill and so on relied on ship. We saw some example in the talk of Yossi just a few minutes ago. But if you look on the ocean class research vessels, typical cost is about 40,000 euros per day. Even if you go to basin class vessel, which will be much cheaper, still the cost is pretty high. If you look on other underwater robots like ROVs and AUV, all of them still require a support ship, and usually they can operate for one, at most for 2 days. On the other end, these gliders can collect the data in a fraction of the cost of such ships. They have, as I mentioned, long endurance, can stay in the water for weeks or for months, and with no risk to human life, you can send them everywhere, regardless of the weather, regardless of the hazard materials in the water. They are not sensitive at all. And if you use more than one glider at a time, if you use swarms of glider, you will get a synoptic view of what's going on, and then you can, of course, manage any event much more efficiently. The market introduction is planned to be in 2020. If you're interested in more details, there's a website and some newsletter that you can get. Thank you.
Thank you, Crazy, especially to
I saw you're nervous.
Yeah. We have time for a few questions, please. Okay. Of course, Jeff.
Sensor packages. What's available? What's planned? What are we getting?
Okay. Many already are available. CTDs we are going to get. There are some for currents. We are not going to have one. There are sensors for hydrocarbon, which we are going to get. Fluorescence we will have. What else? I forgot what we got. But there are already operational sensors also for turbulence, if you want. There are microstructure turbulence. A package that you can put on it, there are oxygen we will have also. There are four dissolved organic matter, almost all the turbidity.
Nitrate.
Yeah, there are quite a few.
Without water sensor?
This we're going to develop in this project. Now you can still cannot take it to glide a water sample, but we will be able to do it in the next generation. What else?
Any other questions? Iran, please.
As I understand, one of the airplane data, like the reporting on the towers, is actually prevent building good models for oil spills or understanding of the system. What is being done in that regard?
So you could already can put an ADCP on such a glider. There are specific models that you can put in this on these even on present day gliders. We didn't got one due to budget limitation, but it is already possible. So maybe in the next coming years when we will be able, we will get more and more sensors. You can also get some idea about the currents just by looking on the track of the gliders, because approximately what should be the downward or upward velocity based on the buoyancy management that you do, and if the actual waves due also to the current, which are superimposed on the effect of the buoyancy, you can get some idea of the current just by analyzing the track of the glider. So this is something that we will certainly do.
Thank you, Fezzi.